Hello there. My name is Mark, aka the Canardian Jedi, and this is episode 94 of Holocron Chronicles. I've got my Spartan co-host, Rebel Forces, ready to go. Charlie Carton, how you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. Fun story about this shirt. I was working an event at the Breslin Center at Michigan State University. That is my alma mater. That is the building in which I graduated back in 1999. This was in 2019. And a young co-ed was attending this Comic-Con that I was helping work at, walked past with a shirt that said this. And I said, oh my God, I'm an alumni as well. I would love that shirt. She said, I got it at the alumni bookstore a couple of years ago. And so I did some research. They said they don't have it anymore. I found something approximating the art. I reached out to my friend Sarah Walter. Can you produce the shirt for me? Boom. Original
shirt. That is awesome.
Yes, exactly. I love it. And I don't, and again, it's 5 years gone by, so I don't necessarily recall what any particular, or if this was like a Star Wars fan club on campus or if it was just some random. It's like I have tons of shirts with random logos, like my, you know, Petoskey 47 pickleball club that I invented for some friends of mine, you know. So I love logos. Mark does all my stuff and he does a great job of it, so not that I'm trying to pimp you out for that, but I'm always very grateful for the logos you put together for me. But yes, I'm very proud of this. I always try to wear a t-shirt of some variety when I'm recording so I show something off, but I was particularly proud of this one because it represents my Sparty. So yes, thank you.
Excellent.
Yes.
This is a slightly different episode. As any Star Wars fan will know, we're kind of in between content right now. We're going to talk about that in a second, but first off, we have to thank all of our supporters over at patreon.com. Charlie.
Oh, yes. Time to pay the bills. Well, if you go over to patreon.com/secretfriendsunite, there is a bevy of bonus, free, ad-free, early episodes like my show, Code 47, where we talk about Star Trek. We always drop 1 or 2 days early over on the Patreon. We've got a great new Patreon exclusive monthly party that Mark and Todd and myself get together with anybody on our Patreon list who feels like doing a show and just having a chat. We play games. We did our first one last month and we have another one coming up in a few weeks here if you're listening to this episode when it comes out. Mm-hmm. So we're very grateful for all these wonderful folks. If you visit that website, you can try us out for 7 days for free. I think you'll want to stick around because we have a lot of fun and I think our content's very enjoyable. So at our besties level, our pal Chris 1H1D, my buddy Derek Trevelyan, the figure dude from right here in East Grand Rapids, Michigan, a lovely lady named Francie, who is my wife's hairdresser, who loves our bad movie podcast. It's so cool. I've never met her, but she shares that with my wife when April gets her haircut. Our friend Luke Lohr, also known as XEP, and my awesome Uncle Tim from South Haven, Michigan. Very grateful. He's my only member of my family who is very supportive of this podcast, so I think that's pretty awesome.
At least you've got one.
Absolutely great guy. I don't think he listens because he's an older fella, but he's very supportive, so I appreciate that. On the Friends with Benefits level, John Storf, the Phoenix Sisters Entertainment, that is our friends Kelly and Crayley, Brendan Myers, Corey and HD, and friend of the show, Matthew Keel. And last but not least, we're going to give a special shout-out tonight to a loss in the family over at the Nias household of the Twin Cities. Sean, Stella, and Henry, they did have the passing of their beloved family pet, whose name I'm forgetting. Do you have the note? Todd, let us know tonight.
Bailey.
Sorry. Bailey. Yeah. So yeah, it sounds like Bailey was a hunting dog. And I was reminded of the hunting dog that my dad had when I was a kid. He was a black lab named Jack. So I know exactly what that's all about. So our hearts go out tonight to our top supporters, the Nias family, Sean, Still, and Henry, obviously all with a heavy heart tonight. So we do love you guys. So at any rate, to wrap up the big, long, rambling commercial, patreon.com/secretfriendsunite, 7 days for free. And I have a funny feeling you'll want to stick around because we have a whole lot of fun. But with that, Mark, back to you.
Yeah, I am actually after, as soon as we record this, I am dropping the next episode. Might take a little bit of editing. Might have to drop it tomorrow morning. We'll see how late I'm up. But new episode of Walk Nerdy with me, where yes! I walk and talk about things. I recorded it a couple of days ago and just have not had a chance to sit down and edit it. So
I know the
I'm
feeling.
Looking forward to doing that and getting it posted as soon as possible. One final note, if you are newly signing up to Patreon, don't use the iOS app if you use Apple devices. Apple adds a 30% fee for all new memberships purchased through the iOS app. It's still a great app to use if you're listening to the shows and doing all that kind of stuff. Just don't subscribe through there.
Right.
Go to the website on any device. Even if you use an Apple device to go to the website, that's still cool.
Right.
Just go to the website.
I mean, I listen to our content on my Apple Podcast app, but of course, I actually facilitate my Uncle Tim's membership, but I did sign up for that on our website for that exact reason. So it's not hard. Just bookmark Patreon, search Secret Friends Unite, and sign up that way. So yes, just a technicality, just because, you know, that's taken away from our ability to really do what we do, and putting money back in the pocket of big podcast, which we don't want to do. We want to support the little guys. We're a small business over here, and we do appreciate your support. All right, so
And the app is great because it lets you comment directly on posts and get all that stuff. You can use a podcast app and send the RSS feed there, but the app is fun. The app is nice to use. So use it as you will. Just skip signing up there. Anyway. With all that stuff out of the way, Charlie, like I said, this is going to be a different episode. We don't really have too much content going on the Star Wars side right now. The Acolyte was a thing. I enjoyed it. Some other people didn't. Some people were mid about it, but there's a lot of people that have been exhaustively trolly about this show, and
you know what's kind of making me sad, and I think I probably brought this up on our Discord, or maybe I did in the chat between you and I and Todd, or maybe it was the chat that I have with John, who's our other very close friend, who's a secret friend founder, is that how Disney seems to be, I guess, treating the Acolyte is kind of how I felt. It's 7 minutes and 20 seconds. I'm talking about Star Trek. Wait, I already did because I mentioned Code 47. Last year during the writer's strike, as a tax write down, the people at Paramount sold off the animated Star Trek program, Star Trek Prodigy. Great show. Still got a second season because it was already complete, but it now lives on Netflix. It's the only Star Trek program that is not on Paramount Plus, including currently the movies. But if you visit StarTrek.com and their merch store, they still sell Prodigy merch. It's still part of the family. And the thing that kind of makes me sad, it was a headline that I saw this week, is that if you visit the Disney store, Acolyte merchandise is going away. Disney is erasing it from Star Wars canon, and I think that is entirely wrong, no matter what I think about the show.
I've heard two different reports on that. One is it's just sold out because when it was canceled, people just, the real fans bought it up. But I have heard that it was just gone. So I don't know which one to believe, but keep an eye out. I saw some Acolyte merch in my local Walmart literally earlier this evening.
Gotcha.
So I don't know.
Well,
there's still stuff out there, but I hope Disney doesn't just erase it and just.
That's my fear because again, to compare contrast to Star Trek, the Prodigy is not the only show that has befallen a cancellation. Let's say they don't go on and make a third season. That's all right. The original show famously canceled. It was canceled three times. It was the third time that stuck. Star Trek Enterprise, the show that starts Scott Bakula in the early 2000s, was canceled on UPN. And there was no Star Trek on TV for a very long time after that. So, you know, but all of those franchises are still respected and considered part of the family. So I would find it some very sad commentary that even, you know, I don't have to like the Acolyte to respect it as part of Star Wars canon. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I would find it very telling and very sad if Disney was like, well, this was a failure because by the metrics, it didn't meet their expectations. It didn't meet their expectations enough for them to renew it. That's a business. I would like to believe it's a business consideration. You know, they looked at it, and of all of the streaming programs under the Marvel IP or the Star Wars IP, it was at the bottom of the stack. And you take that for what it will. Just because something doesn't do well doesn't mean that people can't enjoy it. Mm-hmm. And they did produce it. They did spend their money. So for, you know, if the overall thought process is, well, let's take the eraser and rub it out. You know, the toothpaste is out of the tube. The show has been made. It does have a fan base of its own kind. But you're absolutely right that I just don't understand why people have to pee in somebody else's Cheerios, for lack of a better expression. Why is it necessary? I mean, it's you know, the horse is dead. Why do you have your baseball bat out? They canceled the show. You know what? If you hate it, leave it alone. You're not proving anything by just trashing something, whether you feel it's good or not, or people are going to enjoy it or not. So, I find that very sad. And I, you know, if the real question is, you know, what's the state of Star Wars right now? It could be people are collectively holding their breath. To see if what we get out of, I kept wanting to call it the Skeleton Key when Todd and I were talking on SFU this week, but yeah, the Skeleton Crew with Jude Law, if they're going to see if that delivers, or, you know, the Mandalorian and Grogu film is currently in production, started at the end of June. Are people holding their breath? I would like to believe, and unfortunately the fan base isn't resonating this, that, and again, I keep talking about Star Trek. Star Trek itself, since it returned to television in 2017, has diversified into different types of content. Classic, legacy characters, new characters, different situations, different time periods, animated for children, animated for adults, you know, and it's accepted. It's not accepted in the, you know, in some ways there are some quarters. I was having this conversation with another gentleman who I'm with in the fan club tonight, is that there's some people that you get the cantankerous folks who just need to bitch about things and whatever it is and make a sour experience for everyone. And that's not okay. Fandom should not be a metric for people to say, well, I'm a real fan because of XYZ. It's the same people who say, well, you a Star Wars person or a Star Trek person? What the hell kind of question is that? You know, it's like asking me, do you like War and Peace or do you like Atlas Shrugged? Well, both of them are books. Space opera, space fantasy. The word star is in them. That's kind of where it stops. So I don't know. I've loved both franchises my entire life with passion, extreme passion. I don't know. What's the expression? The goaltender Canadian expression, right? Gatekeep, yeah. Goaltend. Yeah. The classic hockey tradition. I just don't dig it. So, are people holding their breath right now? Is the fandom broken right now? I don't know. I just know that when I turn on and I have a fun experience watching Ahsoka, or I can enjoy it and put it on in the background or scrutinize and really drill down and enjoy something about it, it's I guess ultimately the state of the franchise, as far as I'm concerned, is your mileage may vary. There's no way to say it's good or it's bad for everyone based on my experience. If you love it, love it. If you love Alkalite and the other two gentlemen who were on with us in our last episode, you know, one of them absolutely loved it, and one of them, you know, was a little bit more critical, kind of like I was, and I know you have a lot of warm feelings about it. Mm-hmm. How could that make it any more or less than valid than the people who are making it? I just don't understand. Yeah. I don't understand. And I think it's beyond my understanding to figure out how people could be so hateful or hurtful the same way that Daisy Ridley has been abused or Kelly Marie Tran has been abused for their roles in the sequel films. It's just, just be human and enjoy. It's entertainment. And there are people who are doing a job and bringing you into the movie theater or sitting down in front of your television screen. Just please be human, be kind. That's where I'm at.
That's it. Like for me, the whole Acolyte thing was so exhausting. from just a being a fan perspective of just, you know, wanting to enjoy the thing that I enjoy. And I had my problems with the show, but, you know, at the end of the day, it was, we were still getting Star Wars content. And to just see how deep the trolls were digging in their heels, and every little thing was, you know, this is this and that, you know, this is woke and this is BS and this shouldn't be this. And that's, you know, not Star Wars and this should be canceled. And a victory when it was canceled is, you know, it was very exhausting to me.
How do you celebrate a victory when someone loses their job?
That's it.
You know, because again, you and I have both been on the struggle of being out of a job, looking for a new job. I'm going back and forth with that right now. It sucks. It's the worst. And I've met people who are actors. I've met people who are, you know, true, you know, who have been, you know, part of places like Second City and the Upright Citizens Brigade. I've met people just in my travels, and that's a very tough life. You know, and all of the struggle and rejection that they have to go through. Why would you think it's great when somebody else's livelihood is threatened? I'll never understand. They're still, those actors are still human beings who get up and struggle the same way that all of us do just to make ends meet.
Yeah. The other thing, and this is definitely not exhausting on that same level as the bullshit surrounding Acolyte trolls. But for me, another little thing that was just kind of like taking me out of the Star Wars fandom right now for a second is, I think I mentioned on the last episode that Ubisoft, I'd been talking to Ubisoft Canada. They're usually pretty good, especially with Todd and I doing co-op mode. They're usually pretty good to come through with review codes
for
games. And I talked to them after this one. They just said they didn't have enough. There's another game coming out soon that I think, you know, fingers crossed, they said I'm on the list for, and they apologized for this one, but I didn't get a review code for Star Wars Outlaws. And then started seeing reviews of this game, which are saying, you know, the characters are cool, all this kind of stuff, but there are some stealth missions that are instant fail if you don't do it, and there's this kind of stuff. Charlie, I know you're not a video game guy. I hate stealth games with a fiery passion if they're not done really, really well.
What's a Reader's Digest description of what that means, just for the uninitiated?
So for the uninitiated, complete Reader's Digest is basically you need to be sneaky. You are forced to be sneaky. You cannot Han Solo blast your way through. You need to sneak around. If there are stormtroopers over here, you need to sneak past them very quietly and quickly. And a lot of times it's one very specific path that you have to take, or one you have to sit in a, you know, around a corner and wait till the stormtroopers have a conversation. And then one of them looks over that way and you have like half a split second to kind of dodge while they're, attention is diverted.
It doesn't sound very fun. Yeah.
They are very, in my opinion, very seldomly done well.
Yeah.
Especially if it's a forced stealth. I dig games that are choose your own path. You have a gun, but you also don't have armor. I dig a realistic game. If I get shot once or twice and I'm dead, I have no problem starting over, trying again.
Yeah.
If that's the path that I choose to take, go in guns blazing. Now, usually, you know, and that approach is usually met with, or you can do the stealthy route and you don't have to take that risk and you sneak past and do whatever. And sometimes depending on the game, I'll try the stealthy route. When I get bored of that or when it doesn't work, that's when I go guns a-blazing and I just throw shit at the wall and see what sticks. I like the choice given the situation and how I would react. So the creator of this game has already said they're going to be patching some of the early stealth missions that were really, really easy to fail, and people have been getting hung up on them. So
that's not cool. That's not fun. What's the point?
Not great. So there's a combination of things of one, not getting a review code, which is perfectly fine. 100%. We're a smaller podcast. I don't think I deserve review codes. But when I don't get a review code, that means I have to work it into my budget. And saving up for a Disney World trip, my budget for video games is small, and there's a new Zelda game. It's one of my favorite franchises. I have a Link tattoo from that game. Like, there's other games. I just bought my son a game. Like, there's other stuff that I'm spending money on that is not the $140 special edition Star Wars Outlaws. Especially a Ubisoft game, which, again, for the uninitiated, Ubisoft games tend to go on sale really quickly. So by Black Friday, this game could be heavily discounted, especially with like middling reviews and early patches and all this kind of stuff. However, not being able to play a Star Wars game after dealing with all the Acolyte stuff is just kind of like, whew, where am I at right now?
Yeah,
kind of with Star Wars.
Kind of a, to employ a, an aphorism, or you were just talking about a sour patch.
Yeah. So yeah. I'm lucky I've been building my Mando armor.
It's
and building
stuff.
Up some stuff. I love seeing that. A couple of knives. This is the first I'm showing anyone these knives. I just finished and wrapped this one. I have a bigger model. This one's going to go in my sock. Cause like kilts are usually worn with like big kilt socks, and there's usually a knife stabbed in one of the,
always got
stored in one of the socks. And then the bigger one, has a sheath that I've done with leather and that wrap and all that kind of stuff. So that's been keeping me in the Star Wars universe and keeping my excitement levels pretty good.
I've been doing that with the comics, because the second volume of the mainline Star Wars series is ending, and it's the I was trying to explain this to Todd, not being very successful, because he was like, "Whoa, what does that really mean?" Well, it's 50 issues covering the end of Empire to the beginning of Jedi, and a lot of it had to do with Luke's journey and what took him from, you know, getting his new hand and armor on Leia and watching the Falcon fly off at the end of Empire. And then when we see him wander into Jabba's palace at the beginning of Return of the Jedi and what that all meant. And I've been following that over the last 4 years with a tiny break for COVID in there. And it's been great. Yeah. They're now going to end that series, move into a limited series, and perhaps this is something you and I can talk about, a 3-issue limited series covering the Battle of Jakku, which is the true end of the Galactic Civil War. Yeah, that would I think I already have it pre-ordered, so you can get it on Comixology Unlimited, which would I would very much like to talk about that.
Talk to my comic shop and pre-order that.
Yeah, like, I seem very, very excited about that. That's what's keeping me excited. Again, the Acolyte didn't really do it for me, but I'm looking forward to the Skeleton Key being a marriage of the kind of Amblin Entertainment vibe with the Goonies and E.T. mixed in, and Jude Law, who's a name star, who, if he gets killed in the first episode, like Carrie Ann Moss did, this is going to be a bad omen. That's all I'm saying.
I really hope not.
Yeah that would be bad. That would be case. Bad. So yeah, I'm looking forward to it. And we're getting that the first week of December.
Sounds like it, I think.
If I'm not mistaken.
I can't remember if they have an official release date, if that's just like what people are circling. But that kind of brings me up to what our coverage plans or what our episode plans are for the next little bit. Mm-hmm. I think it's a good time to jump in there.
Yeah.
Because unless Star Wars Outlaws goes on sale, I don't think I'll be covering that on this show until it does go on sale, basically, or
that's fair.
Get really bored and have some extra money, and I'm just like, okay, it's Star Wars Outlaws time.
Right.
Because apparently that's going to be patched in the next like 10 days or so.
Yeah.
So if I'm feeling, you know, extra, I might dabble. But for right now, let's assume that I'll play that later. So our solid plans for coverage next week, Lego Star Wars Rebuild the Galaxy drops. That's this week, September 13th.
We're recording on the 9th, and that's the Friday the 13th. It was funny. I was making an appointment with a client of mine for Friday, and I said, "Oh my God, that's Friday the 13th. Oh my goodness."
Right.
So yeah, there you go. Which is funny, April and I are doing we started our spooky season watchathon, and the original Friday the 13th from 1980 was our first watch. We watched that over the weekend with a very young Kevin Bacon. Came out in 1980. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll be covering that for our next episode. barring some sort of like Disney Plus gets exploded. But I think like that's kind of the plan right now. We also, Charlie was awesome enough to break down pirate heavy episodes and different arcs that we could watch.
It was expansive research on Reddit. I just found one guy and then I made a spreadsheet out of it. But yeah, little arcs from both Clone Wars and Rebels. And it was every arc they did, but then we can say we'll take this one. It's like three episodes, which is nice because you know that's, you know, Mark and I are very busy guys, and of course I do nothing but Code 47, my Star Trek show is nothing but homework because we talk new stuff in the first half and we talk old stuff in the back half, so I have to watch it all and often take notes, you know. And then over on SFU, it's seeing a movie, reading a comic. So I can balance my homework. I put little blocks in the calendar saying today's my day to watch Star Wars stuff. So I can do it.
So we have to throw The Mandalorian in there, season three, at least those episodes where the pirates are in, because some of those same pirates are actually going to be in the skeleton crew. We've had confirmation from some of the actors that these same pirates who were attacking Nevarro are going to be part of the skeleton crew. That's going to that's going to bridge the universe between, you know, or the shows between Mandalorian, and show you that it's in the same place, it's in the same time as this this new show coming.
Are they bringing back the Swamp Thing guy? I can't remember if he died.
I think he died, but some of his crew survived.
Gotcha. And another Swamp Thing guy. Got it.
In there,
So
we've got some content. We will try to fill the gaps in between there, but I just, you know, while we were, like, Charlie and I were figuring out, we knew we had this show today, so you're like, well, let's figure this out and let people know what we've been figuring out, just so they know, you know, we're not going away while content goes away. We're gonna do the Lego stuff, and I have a guest spot on a podcast. I'm not gonna tell which one. You'll just have to pay attention, and we'll drop it when it drops, because I don't know how they drop those episodes, like if they're very quickly after they record or if it's a little bit. So I'll leave that as a mystery for now, but might talk about it the next episode. But I'm excited. I think the it's a weird thing to bring me back into like Star Wars hype levels after things, but like a Lego movie is going to be just that kind of palate cleanser, silly, goofy, stupid kind of like what if kind of thing that's going to remind me of like, oh wait, these are all just for kids.
Yeah.
You know, Star Wars is for kids. Star Wars is just goofy. It's fun. It can be really, really goofy and fun like it is in the Lego stuff.
Yeah.
But it's also for the most part, like for kids.
Right.
You know, like that's kind of how it's always been. You can get more serious stuff like Andor and whatever, and Acolyte and that kind of thing. And that can be hit or miss or whatever, depending on your mood. But like at its core, George Lucas kind of made Star Wars for kids.
Yes. Precisely.
There we go.
Precisely. Well, let's not forget, and I get the vibe we're kind of winding down here, but
one last thing.
News broke just today of the passing of James Earl Jones, the voice of Darth Vader, who voiced him as recently recreating, I'm not sure, in Kenobi just a couple of years ago. But let's not forget of his massive roles in The Lion King in the 90s, his unforgettable role in Coming to America with Eddie Murphy and Arsenio Hall back in the 1980s. The man was an EGOT. He was, help me out here, this was an Emmy, Tony, Oscar, and a Grammy. So a performer going back, he came from the American South, grew up in Detroit, Michigan, my hometown, attended the University of Michigan to study medicine, which is what my grandfather did, though he ultimately didn't become a doctor. I mean, he was at age 93, a legendary career. And as Mark and I were talking about earlier tonight, you know, those of us who are Gen X folks are at the point where all of our heroes are aging out, and they're rejoining each other. In in the land beyond. Right before we got on, Mark and I talked about, because April and I are watching The Big Bang Theory right now, rewatching it, and checked out the wonderful episode in season 7 where Sheldon is attempting to put on his own Comic-Con event, and he seeks out James Earl Jones in a wonderful guest spot, and the two of them become fast friends. And the episode ends by them doing a ding dong ditch it at the home of Carrie Fisher, where she runs out with a baseball bat and says, "It's not funny anymore, James." And he says from the distance, "Then why am I laughing?"
Yeah. Fun fact for anyone listening that doesn't know, that's the first time those two met.
That's in incredible. Real life. I had no idea.
They had, you know, done in those movies, but James Earl Jones only did the voiceover, so never met on set, any of that kind of stuff. So they had never met in person until that episode. And it was like, the father-daughter reunion, but meetup kind of thing.
Right. And now they're able to hobnob in the great beyond, which is fantastic.
That's it. Yeah. He can ding dong ditch all he wants. So a little bit about like the Star Wars role. He was only paid $7,000 for A New Hope and completely declined any screen credit for that film and Empire Strikes Back because he wanted to let David Prowse own that role. He did all the acting. He did the original dialogue. Yeah. I don't know if you've ever heard that, but it's kind of hilarious to hear.
They called him on the British set of A New Hope. They called him Darth Farmer because he speaks with a very heavy rural English accent. So that was mean. That's so catty. It's terrible. Yeah.
He did take credit for Return of the Jedi. He'd become synonymous with the role and really made Darth Vader, I think, the presence of David Prowse and James Earl Jones' voice combined to make probably, in my opinion, the best villain really ever, but one of the best, I think, is kind of inarguable at this point. To something you brought up earlier, he did return for Rogue One, but his voice in Obi-Wan Kenobi was not actually him. He authorized Lucasfilm to use archival recordings and AI technology to recreate it. And he's done that because Darth Vader is bigger than him. So he wanted to make sure that Darth Vader voice that you just can't replicate.
We'll always live on someone else.
You can't get like Vin Diesel or Chris Pratt in to do their Darth Vader voice.
Well,
like,
they can do everything else.
Like if anyone could, maybe Vin Diesel could hit that. We just watched Guardians the other night and he's got that kind of, you know, gravitas.
Yeah.
But like
no
one else is really going to do that. So that's one of those occasions where I'm like, you know what? I'm glad that actor signed off on the AI recreation. It's creepy in some other stances, especially when it's AI likenesses. But I think AI for such an iconic voice, to me, is okay. And I kind of respect that he did that, especially now that he's gone and cannot do that anymore. So for me, it's Darth Vader and Mufasa are the two roles. And I'll tell you something really weird for timing. Like I said earlier, I was in Walmart. Finn and I were going through the checkout. Finn was talking to some people as he does because he's 4 and he talks to everyone. And the woman in front of us was saying that when her kid was Finn's age, he would introduce not only himself, but also her and then give people their home phone number. Which was less than ideal. Finn does not do that. I said, I'm pretty sure if you ask him my name, he's going to say Dada. And
good enough.
Sure enough, the woman said, okay, well, you know, what's your dad's name? And he looked at her and looked at me and looked back at her and went, Mufasa. And I don't know where that came from, but we got back in the car and I looked at my phone and the notification was there that James Earl Jones had passed away. Weird effing timing. Yeah.
That is the force. That is a connection.
Creepily strange timing. Cause I don't know, like we watched Lion King maybe a couple of months ago.
Okay.
He's never ever called me like Mufasa like that. Like that's not.
He just pulled it. He just pulled it out of somewhere. Just.
I genuinely don't know. I laughed about it. I was like, well, that doesn't bode well for my future or my relationship with my brother. But I'll accept it. Right. And literally, we just went. We checked out. I hadn't looked at my phone since I left work and got to the car. Put my phone out to plug in to CarPlay and listen to music on the way home. And Apple News was, you know, James Earl Jones had passed away. So weird timing. But James Earl Jones will absolutely be missed. Had one hell of a career. 93.
You better believe it.
Can't really complain when you make it to 93, but it stings.
Yeah. For sure. Yeah. There's no doubt about it. Like I said, you know, we've been dealing with that in particular in the Star Wars world since we lost Carrie. And it's back in 2016. It's eight years that's gone by, which is absolutely crazy. But we are all but travelers upon this mortal coil. So yeah.
Before we wrap up, Charlie, I have a couple of things. I'm wearing, first off, the Darth versus Obi-Wan shirt. Ooh. I grabbed a couple of things just to show my reverence for this character, because I'm usually a light side guy, but I have a lot of, like, so I have this Darth Vader who's supposed to hold a controller but holds a fossilized megalodon tooth.
I love it. I have two phone holders like that. I have a Spidey in my office, and then I have Boba Fett downstairs. So yes.
Here's one of my favorite Darth Vader collectibles. This is something I don't think I've ever shown.
I do still have. I don't know if I can tilt you backwards, but I have the background. Do you see it?
Oh yes, back there. But that's in this. So it's this.
You can see that background holds there. I have the original hero cast, and of course Black Series figures and the Vader. So I have a couple of Vaders. One of them is over to my side here, and it's in a diorama with Alec Guinness Obi-Wan, a la the episode 4. Yeah,
for any audio listeners, I'm holding up a Kenner Black Series Darth Vader. This was the 40th anniversary. Correct. So I got this years ago,
and it was I bought, and when they went on clearance, I picked up. I still have a bin of. I have an extra one or two of them because I used to use them. It's just because it's a little interlocking stand base with pegs, so you can use it as a display base. Which is nice.
I've never actually opened that case. I've never taken anything out of there, so it's just been sitting on my desk. I gotta give a shout out to my Vader saber. A couple months ago. And another one that I don't think I've ever showed off on the podcast. Charlie, I don't know if you've ever seen this book, but there are dads way worse than you.
I have seen it around. Who's the author on that one?
Glenn Boozin.
Different guy.
Illustrations from Priscilla Witt.
There's a gentleman, and I have a series of books floating around here somewhere, but he's a local who actually was doing a signing at a shop here in town that he went to, that he did one of these kind of animated style of like Luke and Leia's brother and sister, and he signed it for my kids, and that was cool. Number of years back. So I think his last name was Brown, maybe Gary Brown or something like that. I'm drawing a blank. But yeah.
This stuff is just really just a couple of things that I could grab right before we recorded. Darth Vader, like I said, to me, the best villain probably ever, as far as I'm concerned. And I don't know if I talk about that enough, but I have Darth Vader stuff literally everywhere.
Yeah.
There's barely a room in my house that you can go that there's not a poster or like a frame picture up on a wall or a Funko Pop, or I even have like a little granite carving of Darth Vader. Mm-hmm. Like there's just Vader stuff everywhere. It's such
that's awesome.
Such a great character for me. And so that loss today was like I said, bittersweet. You can't really complain about making it to 93.
Right.
But still stings. So
Rest
in peace, Mr. Jones.
Rest in peace. You got it. All right. Well, is that a wrap for us? Are we good?
That is a wrap. We will see everyone next, or 2 weeks from now. We will be covering Lego Star Wars Rebuild the Galaxy. I can't wait to watch this one this weekend.
I love it. No, it sounds like fun. Good stuff. Awesome. Well, Mark, where do people find you out there?
People can find me hanging out in our Discord group, of course, but also on Instagram, TikTok, and Threads as Canerdian_Jedi.
Very nice. I'm in all of those same places, except for TikTok. I don't really dabble that much. But I am at the C3, spelled out T-H-E-T-R-E-E. Oh, I just screwed up that spelling. The C3. You got it. Yeah, I love being in our Discord. That's where the most fun is happening. My wife and I also run a Discord called the United Trekkers of Michigan. Don't have to be in Michigan if you love to talk about Star Trek, but that's a great place to do it. But also, yeah, like we've said, patreon.com/secretfriendsunite, free 7-day trial. That's where all the good stuff is. So tune in. With that, friends, as always, thank you for joining us. I'm going to tell you that sharing is caring, and keep on trucking.
May the force be with you. Rex, play us out.
Do